Around 66 million years ago, an asteroid struck our planet and triggered a mass extinction that wiped out all non-avian dinosaurs. But what if it hadn't? What would our world look like if the dinosaurs still ruled over it? This theoretical timeline is the subject of the speculative zoology book, The New Dinosaurs. Written by Dougal Dixon, who popularized speculative zoology with a trilogy which also includes After Man and Man After Man, that chronicles evolution in the far future. Dixon's work influenced other series you might know, like The Future is Wild and C.M. Kosemen's ambitious All Tomorrows. But The New Dinosaurs is unique in how it imagines not the future, but an alternative form of the present. So, for this entry into the archive, we're going to catalog this other world Dixon conceptualized. Bearing in mind, some of the science is a bit outdated, and it's of course impossible to know exactly what such a timeline would look like. Think of this book, and by extension this video, as just an interesting guess. So let's jump in, and imagine the great asteroid was just another flash of light in the sky. And over the next several million years, the dawn rose on a new order of dinosaurs. Beginning in the continent we know as Africa, humans have, of course, never evolved. Instead, the first new dinosaurs we meet are the strange forest-dwelling tree hoppers and the long-faced wasp eaters. The wasp eater is similar to our timeline's anteater, as both species spend time in the trees and feature lengthy snouts for reaching into insect nests. Dixon classifies these species as Arbosaurus, and his concept of a tree-dwelling dinosaur actually came true to an extent. After this book's publication, paleontologists discovered the existence of microraptors, small tree-dwelling dinosaurs not far off from what Dixon imagined. Moving from the forest to the savanna, we've got the hilariously named flarp, bipedal scavengers descended from the aerial pterosaurs. Like the emu or ostrich we know, their wings are now vestigial, so they're stuck on the ground. Even more stuck on the ground is the lank, massive, unusual grazers also descended from pterosaurs. This species is a pretty clear analog to the giraffe, and some paleontologists have noted it's not the most realistic endpoint for a species like a pterosaur. But the lank are just so funny looking, I can't help but approve of Dixon's creation. And in the desert, the last African species I want to touch on awaits. Beneath the sand is the worm, a super alarming looking organism. Dixon imagines this tube of a creature moves like a snake and can burrow under the sands to catch prey. Frankly, I wonder if our snakes would be offended by the comparison. Heading north to the continent we know as Europe is a species even further away from traditional dinosaurs. This is the gestalt, a species similar in size to ground squirrels, but Dixon imagines they could build complex nests and even form intricate communities. These intelligent dinosaurs are descended from Pachycephalosaurus, thick-skulled lizards not really known for their brains, so it's an incredible transformation. Heading to the south, we have the diminutive Zwim, not a dinosaur at all, but a mammal. The species is close to a modern mouse, and is about as big as mammals get in this alternate reality. This is because mammals were only able to diversify into the species we know today because the dinosaurs declined, which never happened in this alternative timeline. To the north, we have the hefty Trombol, similar in stature to ostriches. The Trombol is a true bird, a classification which is pretty sparse in this alternate reality. Like the mammals, true birds had too much competition to flourish like they do today. Across the ocean to the region we call North America, we've got the truly insane looking Sprintosaurus. The surreal dinosaurs are evolved from the duck-billed dinosaurs of the Cretaceous period, with elaborate crests used for group identification. The Sprintosauruses are similar to the pronghorned antelope in they can run at high speed to avoid predators and have become fully quadrupedal, meaning they walk on four legs. The Sprintosauruses are hunted in turn by the rather deranged looking North Claw, a theropod with a single massive claw for hunting prey. But there's one dinosaur species on the grassland the North Claw can't take down, that being the massive herbivorous monocorn. These huge grazing animals share the large defensive horns of rhinos, but move across the North American prairies in great herds like buffalo. Descended from the Triceratops, they're maintaining their ancestors' niche as large defensive herbivores. Heading to the rainforests of what we call South America, We've got the scale-covered pangolin, a species with an armored defense similar to our timeline's pangolins, who, for the record, are just the best. Nearby, the massive lumberers continue the treetop grazing habits of their sauropod ancestors, although they now feature a trunk much like our reality's tapirs, which both species use to aid in consuming vegetation. Tragically, the lumbers are preyed upon by the fearsome cutlass tooth, a dinosaur whose unique dental arrangement resembles our timeline's Smilodon. Given their frightening nature, you'd expect the cutlass tooth to be a T-Rex's descendant. But nope, the Tyrannosaurus Rex evolved into the rather stumpy-looking Goramon, a species which lacks any front limbs at all. I mean, hey, in our timeline, the Tyrannosaurus's closest living relative is the chicken, so it could be worse. Crossing oceans once again to what we now know as Asia, we've got the mountain-dwelling tatty, a species covered in insulating pseudo-feathers with a rather unfortunate face. The tatty is filling a similar niche to our reality's macaw, a species of monkeys which thrive in similar regions. The tatty's coloring and tree-swinging abilities also make it similar to the gibbon, although unlike either monkey species, the tatty is imagined to be not particularly smart. Another species that will haunt my nightmares, the tree worms are an elongated organism related to the desert worm discussed in the Africa section. And like the desert variety, the tree worm is a snake-like predator, and like many modern snakes, possesses the ability to climb trees and move along branches in search of prey. Pretty unsettling stuff. In a distant valley, a less unsettling but truly unique species lurks. This is the numbskull, a bipedal animal with a swollen-looking head which almost seems humanoid in its appearance. The idea of dinosaurs eventually evolving into a species with human-like intelligence seems fascinating, and has been the subject of numerous other sci-fi books. As interesting as this seems in theory, it's hard to say how likely it is a creature with human-like intellect would ever emerge from dinosaurs, and Dixon doesn't seem too convinced. This is why the numbskull, living up to its name, isn't actually too bright. Further south, we come to Australia, a region with plenty of unique animals in our timeline, and Dixon's vision of the place is even crazier. This is the cribbum, an algae-chomping species similar in build and coloring to flamingos. Unlike our reality's flamingos, however, the cribbum can't actually take flight. One species that can at least get some air through hopping is the guana, the last surviving relation to iguanodonts which hop across the grassy plains. As you can imagine, these dinosaurs have found a similar role to that of kangaroos, and are even at a similar size. Much smaller is the crackbeak, another species with an appearance I find deeply unsettling for reasons I can't quite explain. But nature is about function, not form, and the crackbeak are quite skilled at cracking open nuts, although the species also eats insects, much like a modern Australian kookaburra. And the final Australian dinosaur of note is the clune, a strangely endearing bipedal herbivore with a thick woolly coat. Although not filling the same niche, the animal almost reminds me of the capybara, which has a similar face and peaceful nature. So that might be all seven continents covered, but we're not done with our list quite yet. We still need to explore what sorts of species are lurking in this world's oceans. Beginning near the poles, we have the aquatic plunger, a streamlined black and white organism that's pretty clearly an analog to the penguin. Like most penguins, they're described as adept swimmers with wings modified for hydrodynamic movement. A pretty creative idea for a species, if a familiar one. Far less familiar, however, is the kraken, an aptly named species with a shell that almost resembles a tiny floating island. The kraken has 12 tentacles with deadly stingers, and will eat anything that becomes entangled in its traps. As you can imagine, the kraken is not a dinosaur, but something that resembles our timeline's nautilus. Although our analog to this species, though interesting, isn't nearly as fantastical. And the last species we're touching on is by far the largest. This is the wolk, a huge leviathan which is a descendant of the ichthyosaur that evolved to eat plankton. This massive species is, of course, directly comparable to our world's whales, sharing similar feeding habits and gargantuan proportions. What a creative species. And that's the end of Dougal Dixon's The New Dinosaurs. Like I said in the opening, The New Dinosaurs might be highly speculative, but it's certainly interesting. If you ever get the chance to check out more of his work, I'd recommend it. In the meantime, thanks for watching. If you like this entry into the archive, please lend your support. and like, subscribe, and hit the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.